Hello, good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to the sixth session of ELECO 2021. And this is also the second section in control systems track. I'll be actually executing the chairman. I'll be working as the chairman of this session. My name is Turan Söylemez. I am with the Istanbul Technical University Control and Automation Engineering Department. As far as I can see, for the moment, we have the first two papers authors with us. So in order to keep up with the schedule, I will perhaps I'll start the session, and if the other authors join us, and I can see that the third one is also joining us now, we can listen to them. In this session we have four papers, and the first paper is entitled as Trajectory Tracking of a Quadrocopter Using Fuzzy PD Controller. The paper is prepared by Kaan Soğuz Canbek and Yeşim Öniz from Istanbul Bilgi University. And I believe Kaan is with us to present the paper. So Kaan, the floor is yours.
Thank you, hocam. Hello, everyone, dear colleagues. Welcome. Let me share my screen. Is it okay? Maybe ask that before starting that.
Yes, we can see your screen. No problem.
Okay, thank you very much. Welcome again. My name is Kaan Soğuz Canbek. I'm a research assistant at Bilgi University, and I'm also a PhD student at Yıldız Technical University. Today, I will present you our study conducted under the supervision of Dr. Yeşim Öniz. The title of our study is Trajectory Tracking of a Quadcopter Using Fuzzy PD Controller. In this study, we have accomplish the trajectory tracking control of an UAV using a PD controller in real time. The real time flight tests have been carried out using an AR drone, which is a commercial drone, for square and circular reference trajectories. The drone's position and discrepancies from those trajectories are with their derivatives has been used as input signals to the proposed control scheme. To provide a means for comparison, the conventional PD controller has also been implemented. And the results of our experiments show that the fuzzy PD controller provides better transient and steady state response compared to conventional PD controllers. Model-based control approaches such as PID control or linear quadratic regulators have been extensively used in the literature. However, in the existence of disturbances or uncertainties of the system parameters, impairs the performance of these controllers as they rely heavily on accuracy and precision of the system's mathematical model. But these models assume ideal conditions while driving their models. To overcome the shortcomings of these model-based approaches, model-free methods such as fuzzy logic controllers or neural networks-based controllers have been used in the literature either to completely replace the model-based controllers or to optimize the parameters of the model-based controllers to cope with the uncertainty and the variable operating conditions. As our test platform, we have used a commercial drone. The name of the quadcopter is Parrot Air Drone 2. The drone has 6 degrees of freedom, which three of them are translational and three of them are rotational. And from the onboard sensor circuitry, we can obtain the linear velocities in X and Y axis, and we can measure the altitude of the drone from its altimeter, and also we can obtain the angular position in Euler angles. But due to the restrictions of the internal flight controller, only a certain set of control commands could be given to the drone. These command controls are the linear velocity in Z direction, the yaw rate, and the pitch and roll angle commands. By changing the pitch and roll angles, linear motion in X and Y direction could be achieved. In our work, only the motion in X and Z axes are controlled. As I stated in the introduction, a conventional PD controller is also tested on the drone for comparing the results. The basic control scheme is given on the bottom right. For the PD controller, we have two inputs, the error between the reference position and the current position and the derivative of the error. And the control signal generated by the PD controller is also given below in the equation. There are different methods to determine the gains of the PD or PID controllers, but in practice, they are generally determined by an expert based on some observations. A similar approach has been followed in our work to tune the gains of the PD controller. By applying a fuzzy logic controller, which also relies on the expert knowledge. An important advantage of fuzzy controllers is that they do not require any mathematical models of the system to be controlled. The output of the controller depends solely on the design of the fuzzy sets and the rules used in the fuzzy logic controller. And the basic control scheme is given on the right. Type 1 fuzzy logic systems consists of four major parts. These are the fuzzification step, fuzzy inference, defuzzification, and also the rule base, which is not shown on the image on the right. And again, in our fuzzy controller, we have used the same two inputs, error between the reference position and the current position and the derivative of the error. In the first step of the fuzzy PD controller, the error signals are converted to fuzzy inputs. This is called fuzzification, and we have used five Gaussian membership functions for our inputs. The image on the left shows the membership functions for the error inputs, and the image on the middle shows the membership functions for the derivative of the error. The domain of these membership functions are determined empirically according to our error ranges. And we have used seven Gaussian membership functions for our outputs. As our control signals, we can only use signals between minus one and positive one. The output domain is chosen between those two values. In the next step, which is the fuzzy inference step, if-then type rules are used. With five membership functions for each input, we define 25 rules in total for each fuzzy controller, one for the controller that determines the KP parameters and one for the one that determines the KD, the derivative coefficient. And you can see the rules, the rule tables on the right. In the last step of the fuzzy controller, which is called the defuzzification, the fuzzy outputs coming from the inference engine are converted to crisp inputs. And we have used the centroid method to do so. To validate the performance of our proposed controller, we have conducted real-time experiments on the drone. And we have chosen two different types of trajectories, namely a square trajectory and a circular trajectory in the XZ plane. In the first set of experiments, we use the square trajectory, and we have the square generator that has been generated to investigate the behavior of the controller in the presence of abrupt changes in the reference directions. The experiment starts once the drone takes off and reaches an altitude of 75 centimeters. You can find the given reference and the PD and fuzzy PD results in the figure on the right. To quantify the effectiveness of the proposed control scheme, we have used root mean squared error. The root mean squared error values for the controllers are given in the table. And from the table, it can be seen that the fuzzy PD controller achieves superior performance compared to conventional PD controller. We can also validate the performance of the drone through the figures given on the right, where we can see that there is less deviation from the reference value in both directions, in both in X and Z directions, which means that our proposed controller improves the steady state characteristics of the system. And here you can see the x-axis and the z-axis responses of the system separately. Again, it could be seen that the proposed fuzzy PD control structure has better transient response. You can see that there is less overshoot and a faster rise time for the fuzzy PD controller. The next set of experiments are carried out on a circular trajectory with a radius of 25 centimeters. In this type of trajectory, there are no abrupt changes in any direction. However, it requires a simultaneous control action in both control directions. At the beginning of the experiment, similar to the previous one, the drone reaches an altitude of 75 centimeters. The figure on the right represents the response of the controllers for the circular trajectory. From the presented results, it can be observed that the fuzzy PD controller can provide less deviation from the reference trajectory compared to its classical counterpart and can track the reference closely. Again, we can verify the results through the root mean squared error values given on the table on the left. Again, the x-axis and the z-axis responses are given separately in these figures. From these figures, it can be concluded that the adaptation of the PD controller's gains results in less overshoot, shorter rise time, and shorter settling time compared to conventional PD controllers. In conclusion, in the study, a fuzzy controller has been adapted to tune the KP and KD parameters of a PD controller. For different reference trajectories, the algorithm is tested in real time. It could be said that the proposed hybrid structure provides enhancement in the transient and steady state characteristics. And encouraged by these results, in the future, we are planning to conduct a new study where fuzzy type 1 sets will be replaced by fuzzy type 2 sets. Thank you for listening and for your attention. I can answer your questions now.
Okay, thank you. Also, thank you for keeping the time. If you have any questions, you may direct the questions using the Q&A chat box, which should be available at the bottom of your windows. And while if there is any question, if somebody writes the question, perhaps I may ask a question in the meantime. Obviously, it's great that you have done an experimental comparison between two types of controllers. One thing that I wonder is that if you have tried to add integral effect to your PID controller, so not just PD, but perhaps PID, and also probably you have done some simulation studies before getting into the experiment. So you might want to share your experiences in that respect as well.
Yes, thank you for your question, Hocam. Yes, we have conducted simulations first, and there we also tested the adding and the integral effect to the system, but we haven't achieved a better response when adding the integral effect, so because there was no benefit during the simulations, we didn't try it in the real experiments as well. But that could also be tested in the future.
Okay, and how did you determine the coefficients of the PD controller? Trial and error, brute force, or any tuning methods?
I think we have used the Ziegler-Nichols method to find them, but then after the simulation, there are some fine tuning and testing.
Okay. For them, as well. You have used tuning.
Yes.
All right. Okay. Do we have any other questions or any questions? Okay, in that case, I'd like to thank Council for the presentation.
Thank you. Thank you for listening.
If this was a real environment, we would applaud you. So you have to be content with this for the moment.
Thank you.
So let me see. The next presentation is entitled as BLDC Motor Driven PSO Optimized 2 Degree of Freedom PID Control of the Seesaw Balance System. The paper is prepared by Ibrahim Çukdar, Tevfik Yiğit, and Hakan Çelik from Fırat University. As far as I can see, Tevfik Yiğit is with us to present the paper.
Yes.
Okay.
So I share my screen?
Yeah, sure. The floor is yours.
My voice is audible?
Yes.
Firstly, I want to say welcome to participants. My name is David Keats. I'm working at Fred University Department of Mechatronics Engineering and as a research assistant. Also, I have been continuing my PhD studies. I hope to finish my thesis next year. If I give information about the work that I will be presenting, this study is belong a part of my colleague Ibrahim's master thesis. He is also one of the authors. If we take a look at the content of the presentation, firstly, summary of the study, a brief abstract. Brushless DC motor and its equations and MATLAB simulink model will be presenting. Two rotor balance system and its equations and simulink model will be presenting. Later, control structure of the two rotor balance system and its optimization process will be presenting. Lastly, the results and conclusions will be shown. In this study, stability control of two rotor unmanned aerial vehicle for which various test studies have been continued recently for its use in the field of the logistics was carried out. Brushless DC motor used as drive element and seesaw balance system in the study is modeled in MATLAB simulating environment. The seesaw balance system is important for the analyzing two multi-rotor systems basically and being basis of the Syncraptor UAV systems. The created two-rotor seesaw balance system model was run both classical PID and 2 degrees of freedom, 2DOF PID controllers, and the results were compared. The parameters of both controllers used in the study were determined by the particle swarm optimization, PSO. When the results obtained from the simulation were examined, it was seen that the 2DOF PID controller had better performance than the classical PID controller. I want to pass these well-known equations to not boring you. The equations of the stator winding for BLDC is expressed as equations 1 to 4. Using equations 1 to 4, the equations 5 to 7 can be obtained. If the sum of the phase currents is assumed to be zero, using equations 1 to 4, phase-to-phase currents can be written as equation 9 and 10. The relationship between the electromagnetic torque of the motor and its speed can be written as equation 11 and 12. Back EMF and electromagnetic moment can be expressed as in the equations 13 to 18. Systems with four or more rotors are complex and difficult to control. For the control of these systems, it's necessary to examine the dynamic behavior of a simpler structure of the system. For this reason, this study, the MATLAB simulating model of the two-rotor seesaw balance system was prepared and the dynamic behavior of system was examined. When the frictions are neglected, the forces acting on the system according to Newton's laws can be expressed as in the figure on the left. In the seesaw balance system, after the voltage is applied, the motors, the propellers start to rotate and produce a moment that tries to turn system to directions of the F1 and F2 forces. We have three controllers in here, as seen in the figure on the right. Two of them are used for the motors to follow reference velocity value. Other one is used for the following angle reference value of the system. The dynamic equations of the equilibrium system given in here, according to Newton's laws, we can see system schematic more clearly here. Both controllers are mounted on the system. You can select one which you prefer and you can work with it. The controller on the left controls the angle of the system. The other two controllers seen in the middle controls the motor velocities. These two controllers are identical. Also, motors are identical. MATLAB simulating model of the seesaw balance system was created by using equation 22 and 23. It can be seen in figure. The forces F1 and F2 obtained from the shaft of the VLDC motor were applied to the balance system whose model is shown in figure. The difference between the theta angle obtained as a result of the forces applied to system and the reference value was applied to controller input, and the reference speed value for the VLDCs was obtained. The difference between this reference speed and the actual speed of the VLDCs has been applied to the controller again, and the system provides to follow reference position value. control of both balance system and PIDCs is accomplished as closed loop with classical PID and two DORF PID controllers. We have been determined the parameters of the both two DORF PID and classical PID controllers. Optimization can be defined as the use of specially developed methods for the best and most efficient working conditions with the most cost-effective solution to a problem. The biggest aim of optimization is always reach the best by providing high profit with low cost. When we have been start the optimization script determines the parameters randomly. These parameters goes as input to our Simulink model of the two-rotor balance system. Simulation results gets as feedback to optimization script to calculate cost. In every iteration, this process repeats. If the optimization reaches the reaches to stop conditions, best obtained value is used. Here we can see operating parameters of the optimization. We used 100 particles and 100 iterations. Also, we used integral of the time absolute error to the calculated cost. Parameters of the BLDC motors and two rotor balance system we can see here in table two. I said that initially we used BLDC motor to actuate our system for the optimization process and during the getting results, we used these parameters for the identical two BLDC motors. Also, we can see parameters of the balance system here, bottom of the table. The parameters determined as a result of the optimization are given in table three for classical PID and in the table four for two DOF PID. Totally six parameters for PID, 10 parameters for the two DOF PID controller. The MATLAB Simulink model of the two rotor seesaw balance system with the BLDC drive was firstly run for 10 degree reference position for classical PID and two DOF PID controllers whose coefficients were determined by PSO. The position change given in the figure was obtained. We can see here the two DOF PID has better rising, settling and overshot results. When if operation scenario repeat for minus 10 degree, we obtain this result. We can see here the two DOF PID has better results than classical PID again. When the figures were, are examined, it's understood that the system with two DOF PID controller for both reference values catches the reference faster with less overshot and thus performs better than the classical PID controller optimized under the same condition. In table five, the velocity results obtained from the both two DOF PID and classical PID controllers are given as more detailed according to criteria of rising time, overshot settling time, and steady state error. It's seen that the system responds that with two DOF PID controllers better than with classical PID one. This situation is also seen in the results given in table five. When the figure 10 and 11 are examined, it's seen that the two DOF PID controller catches reference value more quickly. In this study, a BLDC drive two-rotor seesaw balance system model in MATLAB Simulink environment was controlled. Then the controller coefficients were determined with the PSO algorithm and the performances of the controllers on the system were compared. When the classical PID and TUDOF-PID controller performances of the system operated with different reference values are compared, it has been observed that the TUDOF-PID controller gives better results than the classical PID controller according to simulation results. In the further studies, the performance of the system will be tried to increase with the adaptive fuzzy TUDOF PID controller, which is an improved version of the classical PID controller and combine the fuzzy logic and the TUDOF PID controller. Thanks for listening.
Okay, thank you, Tevfik, for this nice presentation. Again, if you have any questions, please don't forget that you can use Q&A chat box to direct your questions. In the meanwhile, just to clarify something, you have done simulations mostly to have this comparison between 1 degree of freedom and 2 degree of freedom PID structures. Is that right, David?
Yes.
Okay. Can I also see the structure of your 2 degree of freedom PID control, the block diagram?
It's available in my paper, we don't add here.
Okay, I thought that I missed. Is it a PIPD type control or because there are many different types of 2 degree of freedom PID controllers? That's why I'm asking. I was going to ask if you have tried different types of these structures, because as you may know, we have several possibilities.
Yes, we don't try different types.
Okay.
But yes.
Just the one that you have used in the paper, you have tried that. Okay.
Yes.
All right. In your optimization, you, as far as I understood, you have used simulations and then you had this objective function to minimize
to error.
Error or whatever. Is that correct?
Yes, yes.
Okay. In these simulations, have you also considered possible noise or disturbances?
No, they don't add any disturbance or noise.
Okay, so you assume that there was no disturbance and no noise in the system. Yeah. Yes, is that correct?
Yes, okay. Very ideal conditions.
Okay. Probably if you had added measurement noise, you will see the advantages of 2 degree of freedom structure in a more clear way.
To improve optimization?
Yes, but still, yes, I mean, that's what we expect from 2 degree of freedom control structures, because we have more parameters to adjust. Yeah. And we can reduce the overshoot, we can make a faster system and so on. Okay, so it's a nice, nice way of repeating the knowledge that we know in another way in a system that you had. So thank you.
Thank you so much.
If we don't have any questions, I cannot see any in the Q&A box or in chat box. So we, I believe that we thank to the presenter, Tevfik, and then continue with the third presentation. The third paper in today's session is entitled Implementation of Linear Active Disturbance Rejection Control for a DC Motor System. The paper is prepared by Gökhan Yüksek, Alkan Alkaya, Ahmet Naci Mete from Mersin University. And Gökhan Yüksek is with us, so I believe he will be presenting the paper.
Hi, Professor.
Okay, Gökhan, the floor is yours. You may start whenever you wish.
Thank firstly, I want to say welcome to participants and my colleagues. I'm Gökhan Yüksek from Mersin University.
Gökhan, there is a problem with your sound. I don't know, it could be because of the bandwidth of the internet where you are.
I'm checking.
Okay, I'll close my video just in case, and then you may continue. Let's try it once again.
Can you hear me now?
It is coming, but it's not in good quality.
I will try to use my earphones.
Okay, so perhaps you may try to switch your internet connection.
Can you hear me now well, Professor?
Yes, it's much better now.
Okay.
So let's try it this way.
Firstly, I want to say welcome to participants and my colleagues. I'm Gökhan Yüksek from Mersin University. I'm research assistant on electrical and electronic engineering department. Today, I will make the presentation of our study, implementation of linear active disturbance rejection control for a DC motor system. Firstly, I'm going to give our contents for this presentation. I will talk about first our motivation and then what is the active disturbance rejection control and why we are using it. And what is the benefits of linear active disturbance control and the linear extended state of Then I will talk about our experimental setup. Lastly, you will see our experimental results and conclusions. Firstly, I want to talk about our motivation. Daily control is still dominant in practice due to the fact that controllers designed by advanced control theory are hard to tune and maintain besides the hardware implementation. The three parameters of the PID controllers are directly related to the performance of the controller. So control engineers can easily tune them when necessary without knowing much about the control. However, due to the structural limitations of PID controllers, PID control may not achieve desired performance for the complex. Moreover, PID cannot have an ability to detect that the internal and external disturbances or answers. If you want to change the PID with a control technique to overcome this problem, this control technique must have a fixed structure. The structure should be easy to implement in practice. And it must have just few tuning parameters. And the parameters are directly related to the performance of the closed loop system. And also, this technique must predict or estimate the error between the output and the set point in the real time so that better control performance can be. With this motivation, we research about the active disturbance rejection. This technique proposed by Professor Han from China instead of the PI. And Han's first study title was Active Disturbance Rejection Control More Than PID. And he describes this technique as the PID of the 21st century. The central idea is to create the internal uncertainty and external disturbances as a generalized and try to estimate in real time by an extended state observer and then use it in the feedback with the aim to compensate the difference quickly. ADRC configuration, you can see in the figure, the block scheme. In there, B contains the gain information, control plan. TD is the tracking differentiator and this is used for to get the desired response from the response reference. ESO is the extended state observer and it is used to estimate the generalized disturbance and the planned output. And MLSEF is a nonlinear state error feedback that utilizes error and its derivatives of various order in a nonlinear fashion to good control practice. This structure is not hard to implement with the modern digital computer, as and is shown to be able to achieve a good control practice. However, the structure is still complex and needs to tune a bunch of parameters, which makes it difficult to use in practice. To overcome this difficulty, researchers proposed a method which named a linear ADRC. And this technique is the actually linear version of ADRC, which includes linear extended state observer and linear state feedback. Here is the scheme of the linear active disturbance rejection. Here is the LESO is used for the estimating the generalized. It has only one parameter for tuning. This is important. This parameter is observer band. In ADRC technique, there isn't any information about B, but B parameter. But in linear ADRC, B is partially known as B0. And it is accepted as approximately equal to the B. Other parameters, Kp and Kd, are directly depends on the control loop bandwidth of the system. The number of parameters for the linear ADRC is reduced to two, the controller bandwidth omega c and the observer bandwidth omega zero. And these two parameters are closely related to the performance of the system. The linear ADRC technique provides robustness with minimal system information. With an extended linear state observer in its structure, linear ADRC detects the disturbances and changes that occur in system dynamics and ensures the system. Linear ADRC is used to make systems stronger against internal and external disturbances. It can instantly detect and regulate the disturbances in the system. It is partially independent from the system model. Here is the formulation of linear ADRC. In the first equation, you can see the differential equation of the generalized second order. Here, Y represents the output and U is the input. W represents the external noise and A and B are unknown parameters, but B is partially known, as we say before, B0. If we rewrite the equation according to the partial information of B, we can obtain the second equation. And we accept all unknown parameters as F. And this F is a generalized disturbance. And we can write the equation as in the as in the second equation, F plus B0 times U. as say in here, F is defined as generalized and generalized disturbances, which includes internal and external. We can't measure or detect it, but we can observe it. To design an observer to detect the F, we need the state space model of the system, as shown in equation 4, 5, and 6. Here, X3 equal to the F is added as an augmented state representing total disturbance of the system. And H is the derivative of F in this equation. And here is our linear extended state observer. The total disturbance F now can be estimated with a state observer designed for the system in state space model. Here in the eighth equation, L is the observer gain vector and can be obtained by Poiseuille pole plane. And by using F hat, this F hat is the estimation of F provided by a linear accident state observer, a control signal can be generated as in the 90. By applying U compensate U input as U control input compensation, the system is reduced to a unit gain double integrated control problem as in 10. Since the total disturbance F estimated by linear extended state observer and compensated dynamically by the control input, zero steady state error can be achieved without any integration. This is the biggest benefit of linear ADRC. Then a PD controller can be suitably chosen at equation 11. In here, R is the reference, and here derivative action just for output variable Y just applied for to output variable Y only to prevent set point differentiation. Closed-loop transfer function is then obtained in the 12, and as you see, this is the general second-order transfer. And the PD controller gains can be set as in the equation 13 from the rule of generalized second-order transfer function. Here is the zeta is the damping ratio, and the omega is the control loop bandwidth. And now we need to talk about the design parameter. The choice of omega C is determined by the designer to provide the desired transient. In the theoretical study, it is possible to choose higher bandwidth to improve the system transient response and stability. But in the experimental study, the physical laws must be taken into account. These two bandwidths is changing depending on each other with the formulation 40. In observer design, there are factors to be accounted for, such as sensor noise and sampling. Sensor noise varies depending on the hardware, and omega zero optimization is to select the observer bandwidth at the highest possible value, ensure the sensitivity of the sensor noise and delay in the sampling are accepted. Higher bandwidths of omega zero speeds up the linear extent state observer, resulting faster detection of total disturbance, and hence better compensation. Observer poles could be placed at omega zero as suggested in equation. And omega zero parameterization refers to assigning all observer poles at omega zero and expressing all parameters of the observer as a function of omega. And this is the simplifying the design. After our theoretical information about the linear extended state observer, I want to show our experimental. Here you can see in the figure, you can see our experimental setup, and this setup is constituted by 12-volt DC gear model with encoder and the IBT2H bridge module as the motor, and a power supply and a computer. And also we use MATLAB Simulink Arduino hardware support package for data acquisition and control purpose. And here our DC motors parameters. DC motors parameters are estimated by MATLAB Simulink parameter estimate. And according to these parameters, second-order transfer function of DC motor was obtained as seen on the equation 17. Actually, we know all the parameters of DC motor, and we had the exact transfer function. We used this complete information just for tuning the conventional PID parameters for comparison with our linear ADRC. Formulation of generalized generalized differential equation of system was stated in equation one. See, in here, differential equation form on 18 and 19, we know A and B parameters, but for the design of linear radiators, we accepted that we don't know anything about A parameter, and we accepted the B0 parameter as 300, which is quite bigger than the real volume, B273. As we described as before, we must have partially partial information about B, and A parameter and part of B parameter is the part of F which generalized. Then experiment was handled for the choose of suitable band. Here our first experiment. Firstly, experiments were performed for different control loop bands, omega c, and results were compared. Observer bandwidth omega zero is selected as a triple of omega c one, three times omega c two. Therefore, only B0 and omega c are employed for linear ADRC design. Figure shows the step response of linear ADRC design for omega c equal to 6, 8, and 10 radian over. As expected, transient response of the linear active disturbance rejection function gets faster with increasing omega c value. In steady state region, higher omega c value, the higher the fluctuation around the set. As we said before, designed by a controller according to design requirements. And in this figure, tracking performance of linear ADRC, when the reference is combination of step and ramp functions with different rates are given. It was observed that the designed controller successfully followed the reference with slight difference. Experimental studies showed that the maximum value of the control loop bandwidth around omega c equal to 10 radian radian over a second for our DC model. Above this value, overshoot value exceeds the 15%, and this situation can be dangerous for a DC motor system, especially around the maximum speed range. Then, linear ADRC is also compared with the conventional PID. For the fairness of comparison, PID is tuned by a meta PID tuning application after many trials to get the best. We tried to so many PID parameters and choose the best. And PID parameters are given in the table. Figure shows the step response of linear ADRC PID. Linear ADRC is shown to have better transient response with a smaller overshoot and faster set. It also has better steady state response with a smaller ripple. And also in this experiment, we choose the omega C as the biggest value, omega C equal to 10 radian over second. And also this figure also shows the tracking performance of linear ADRC and PID controllers for the custom build. As in the previous case, PID controller suffers higher overshoots and higher fluctuations around the set point at the steady state. On the conclusion, in this study, an existing technique on the literature, linear ADRC design, is explained and then applied to the speed control problem of DC model. And table shows the normalized performance in this PID and linear ADRC. You see from the results that the designed linear ADRC controller is more successful than the PID. Effect of omega C on tracking performance of linear ADRC investigated by an experimental. And it's shown that as omega C gets higher, transient response of linear ADRC gets faster with higher overshoot and higher. Thanks for attention. I can take your question.
Okay. Thank you, Gökhan, for this nice presentation. So again, I'd like to remind all the attendees that you may ask your questions using Q&A chat box. In the meantime, perhaps I might just ask something to have a better understanding. So you have done all this, and it's nice that you have done an experiment as well. Have you tried the effects of modeling uncertainties in your proposed controller, in active disturbance rejection type of controller, and also for the PID type of controller you have found?
Actually, on the PID controller, we didn't take into account the disturbances or uncertainties. But in the linear radio ADRC, on its nature, rejecting the uncertainties and the unknown disturbances under the formulation of F. I thought about the F, generalized disturbance.
Yes.
Actually, I think line ADRC control technique is rejecting the uncertainties on its nature.
Yeah, as a general rule, actually, if you have a nice disturbance rejection, usually you have also a nice robustness performance with respect to model uncertainties, but there might be some exceptions. So that's why I have asked whether you have done some particular experiments on this. For example, as far as I could see from the picture of your experimental setup, your DC motor had no load. So have you tried to use different types of loads with your DC motor and try to control it with the same controller?
We didn't try, but I'm taking my notes. We will take these experiments.
Yeah, you may give it a shot perhaps, and then it could be perhaps another topic for you examining the modeling uncertainties in such experiments. I cannot see any other questions in chat box or Q&A. In that sense, perhaps it's best to thank Gökhan for the nice presentation. Okay, thank you. So this brings us to the last presentation of this session. The title of the presentation is A Low-Cost 3D Printed Soft Pneumatic Actuator. And the paper is prepared by Baver Tüysüz, Emre Güney, Dahan Serpiciler, and Mehmet Ayyıldız. As far as I can see, Emre Güney is with us to present the paper. So Emre, the floor is yours. You may start whenever you wish.
Hello, everyone. I'm happy to attending this conference. I'm Emre Güney. I new graduated from Departments of Mechatronic Engineer in Bilgi University. Our advisor, Assistant Professor Mehmet Ayıldız. And our presentation about a low-cost 3D printed soft pneumatic actuator. Its presentation contents have introduction, materials and methodology, soft actuator design and analysis, results, validation and conclusion. Nowadays, soft actuator have started to be used in many fields, especially in robotic arms and robot motion systems. These developments led to the production of robots having soft robotic actuators inspired by nature. In conventional robots, most of them are made hard materials such as aluminium, steel, and titanium. They are manufactured by mechanical and numerical control machining tools, resulting in relatively higher cost than the fabrication of soft actuators. In soft robotics, actuators are commonly produced by casting silicones into the 3D printing molds or 3D printing of flexible filaments. In this study, a cost-effective 3D printer capable of the printing soft actuators was developed. We printed the test samples to calibrate the 3D printer and tune the best configuration and software settings. Then we designed a novel soft pneumatic actuator capable of achieving a programmable bending motions and explored this programmability by simulating the trajectory of actuator motion using by Ansys Mechanical. Finally, we 3D printed the optimum soft actuator design and conducted experiments to validate our simulations based on the deformation and pressure data. In this slide, firstly, a low-cost 3D printer was made that could print flexible filament to produce a soft actuator. You can see the left side, the 3D printer time-lapse, 3D printing building time-lapse. A custom-built 3D printer can print soft and flexible materials. Figure of parts, the 3D printer in the right side, the most important parts of components are stepper motors, extruder, hot end, and snail fan. A stepper motor using extruder, which can control X, Y, Z axis during printing. The extruder transmits the filament with the motor to hot end and nozzle parts. The hot end is the part that melts the filament before it reaches the nozzle, which can be adjusted according to melting temperature of the filament. A snail fan used to control adhesion of the layers during output. It enabled us to use extruder efficiently in the printings without being affected by the high temperature of the nozzle. As you can see in the left side, extruder system was designed kind of the direct drive extruder. That means the extruder pushed the filament directly into the hot end. Hence, this type was preferred to prevent the flexible filament from coming out of the extruder hole. Double thread direct drive system is more advantageous in the transmitting the filament efficiently than the single threading direct drive extruder. A double threaded direct drive system was designed and implemented in our 3D printer, as shown in the left picture. This system has enabled us to achieve a more efficient printing by eliminating problem of disassembly and reassembly of the extruder in case of a possible problem in the filament transfer. The most important point for making a 3D printer was power of the stepper motors could lift weights. In minimum required torque of a stepper motor in the worst case scenario was calculated, that means the highest load. It using the equation also parameters are obtained top of the picture. When putting all parameters for this equation, F effort was calculated as 23.6 Newton. The highest load tracked by a stepper motor was calculated 9.03 Newton based on the weights of the carried parts. Also, the torque can calculated by T-hold equal F effort times moment arm distance. Moment arm distance was 4 millimeter, so T-hold was calculated as 9.44 Newton centimeter. For the two stepper motors carrying the highest load, so we can easily say T-hold, if T-hold was for 4.72 Newton centimeter for one stepper motor, which was lower than the holding torque of the stepper motors used in the prototype, which is 40 Newton centimeter in the given technical data. Therefore, the specifications of the selected stepper motors were sufficient for meeting the requirements in our application. In the soft actuator design, the calibration samples having the thin walled shapes and curvatures were printed to test performance of the 3D printer at different geometric complexities, as shown in the left picture. Various problems were encountered in different geometries. However, it was possible to fix them with the Cura parameters. You can see in the right side. Printed soft actuators must be airtight because air can leak through the micro voids. Therefore, our extruder temperature must be high enough for the layers to bond more tightly together. 0.4 millimeter nozzle size was important in this study, as it printed the layers smoothly and prevented air permeability in the Cura program. How the nozzle moves and how it gives the minimum burr during the printing process could be adjusted. The 3D printed parts must be consisting of the at least 5 layers, since we wanted to maximize its air tightness. Therefore, the wall thickness configuration in the Cura setting was set to 0.4. Also, we wanted to avoid sticking problems and bubble formations between the layers in the printouts. We adjusted the printing speed accordingly. This geometry includes a thin walled structure with 7 bumps connected to bottom tubing. This structure can be pressurized through a hole which is 0.4 millimeter located at the side of the actuator. Bonding box encapsulating the structure had a length width height of 114 millimeter times 25 millimeter times 25 millimeter. In addition, in this, a 1.2 millimeter fillet was applied to inner and outer corners. In before the analysis, we identified, you can see it in the left picture, we identified a hyperelastic material, which has our thermoplastic polyurethane material appearances in ANSYS. The test data include in the ANSYS, we just select Yoh third order parameter, because the Yoh hyperelastic material model is the phenomenological model for the deformation of the nearly incompressible and nonlinear elastic materials. Also, Ninja Flex TPU material, which is used, it is more suitable to Yoh hyperelastic model. When we solve curve fitting to identify material constants, we got C1, C2, C3 parameters. These parameters represent stress-strain relation in three parameters. Soft actuator design and analysis part, ANSYS mechanical was used in the finite element simulations. The geometry and mesh of the soft actuator architecture is shown in the figure. You can see we tried to keep element quality at the optimum level, so that the results are close to reality. When we give 1 millimeter mesh size, and also you can see the right picture physics preference selected nonlinear mechanical, that means our simulation has not linear relation holds between applied force and displacements. Also, element order was selected quadratic for improving mesh quality. As a result of this, when we generate mesh, according to mesh matrix, we obtain 0.84 mesh average. This is the good quality for 5255 elements. In ANSYS mechanical, before solving finite element simulation, we fixed one support to see bend and actuate. And also in the right pictures, we gave a standard earth gravity for the simulation to be close to the real value. Bottom picture, we identified where pressure apply while during the simulation. It has identified with the section cut and selected inner areas. In the result part, FAM simulations were performed to predict the deformation properties of the soft actuator. The total deformation of the soft actuator under 115 kilopascal and 175 kilopascal were presented in these figures. At the 170 5 kilopascal, a maximum total deformation is obtained 159.05 millimeter was calculated. Validation part, experiments were performed with the printed soft actuator to validate the simulation results in these figures. The pressure was introduced using a compressor and controlled via digital pressure gauge at 115 kilopascal and 175 kilopascal. The design was checked for air leaks by placing the soft actuator underwater to control water bubbles. No air leakage was observed in the prototype. When the applied pressure was removed, it was observed that the soft actuator went back to its initial parallel state. These results proved that the actuator could achieve deformation state where the tip of the actuator was oriented about 90 degrees with respect to the other end. The achieved deformation range can allow soft actuators to be implemented in various applications, such as functioning as robotic gripper when multiple actuators are mounted together. In conclusion, this study, a new cost-effective 3D printer can print flexible components, was developed. The 3D printing procedures were calibrated by producing samples and comparing the dimensions with the desired values. Then a novel thin-wheel bolt structure that can be used as a soft pneumatic actuator was designed. Finite element analyses were performed to characterize the deformation properties using ANSYS mechanical. Afterward, the prototype was fabricated and its bending motion was examined under two different pressures. The result revealed that the bending behavior of the soft actuator in the simulations and experiments was comparable. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you, Emre, for the nice presentation and also a very interesting one, I believe. Do we have any questions? If you have any questions, you may use Q&A chat box or the chat box you can also use. All right, actually, this is a topic that which I'm not very familiar with, but I think it's a very interesting topic and it's a very encouraging topic. So we can see that things are done in very different ways, and then we can, and probably we will have some very interesting, flexible, materials printed by flexible actuators or soft actuators. So it's nice to see such developments. I don't know, I wished we had some video or something to see the process, because as I said, I'm not very familiar with the subject. So I will be very much interested in to see how this thing is actually done in action.
Yeah, if you want, I can send a video we have in these topics videos. I send your email if you want, Mr. Professor.
All right, that would be very interesting, actually. Thank you very much. I mean, that would be a personal favor for me.
Thank you
so much. Okay, thank you. If no questions, I don't have any particular question, just to say that this is an interesting topic and has a lot of features. I believe anybody can see that this has incredible amount of interesting applications and probably we'll see many of them in near future. All right. Thank you very much. So I believe this is the end of today's session, and I'd like to thank all the presenters for their presentations and also for all the participants for joining us in today's session. So I don't know, perhaps Eleko is taking a picture. If not, perhaps I can take a screen capture if you allow me. So if you just open your videos and then we can smile all together, have a picture to remember. Why not? Not bad. And perhaps just one another one, just in case. Okay. Thank you very much. So I believe we can finish today's lecture here. So thank you for joining again.
Thank you so much.
Okay, bye now.